if you win this race, you know, you're number one in the United States in racing.
Up until now, I've been such a hockey fan. I thought it was the world's fastest and most exciting sport in the world. I still dig it. But I stumbled on this thing here, and I'm telling you, the women's race just finished, and it was so hot.
After 9 days and 700 miles, one rider will stand alone on the winner's podium with the lowest cumulative time for all stages. George Mount, USA, the top American rider in modern Olympic history.
Give me some water.
Up there. Hey,
give me some water.
Up there.
Give me some water.
Give him the tag up there.
Give me some water.
Up there. Hey,
give me some water.
Up there.
Give me some water.
Give him the tag up there.
George and Connie drive to the course in the car George won at last year's Classic.
We do have a dream together that what we'd like to do is run some type of a sports camp for children between the ages of like 12 and 14.
It has become America's largest and most prestigious international cycling competition.
And a lot of riders are just going to fry, both literally from the heat and also from doing too much work.
Popped right back up, and Dale Stetton gave me his bike, and I rode on that for a while till I realized that my shoulder was really sore, and it just kept getting worse, so I had to quit.
If I'm ever going to win this race overall classification, I'm going to have to at least lap the field twice, which is an extremely difficult task.
Now, it appears that Boyer has done the impossible.
He has gone around this track three times more than Antonio Londoño to take the lead of this bicycle race, the Coors International Classic overall.
Because last year they forgot to cut the thorns off the roses, and the girl had her hand up in the air, and there was this blood coming down her arm.
Susan, they tail stones.
What is this? He's got the green hair. You've got the earring.
As the long climb to the finish line begins, LeMond makes his move, hammering past Oleg Lugvin to take the lead. But Baranov is instantly on his wheel in a furious dash for the summit. After 92 miles, it all comes down to a matter of inches. Though LeMond is beaten, he's managed to protect his lead in the overall standing.
The leader is going to be Greg LeMond, who comes.
Okay, so how much is this cream for?
$50.
Okay. From the Acupuncture Center of Boulder?
Yeah, Acupuncture Center of Boulder.
All right.
For the men's and women's individual winners, Americans Connie Carpenter and Greg LeMond, it's the gold medals and a proud day.
While back in the pack,
but Graywall soon found himself with a problem. Water. Without it, the legs that had carried him for so long would begin to slow. Water. The Soviets, now predators, and their prey growing weaker. And help soon came on a motorcycle. Water. But it was too late. Graywall was finished. And he could only watch as the Soviet Demidenko took his red jersey forward and to victory.
And Davis, hometown boy makes good, isn't it?
Oh boy, it's about time. You know,
I've never won this race, and I've ridden it about 5 years now. This is the greatest feeling in the world.
Could you hear the crowd pulling for you?
Oh, yeah, it was unbelievable. Last couple laps, I couldn't hear anything the entire way around. It was just one constant roar.
Let's go back to Brett Musburger in New York.
All right, John, fine job out there in Colorado.
I was looking around on the last lap for Ron, and he shot up there on the hill. And that was all she wrote. You know, we dusted everybody.
We used to be so competitive together. And we used to just duel all the time. And now, you know, it's just the opposite. We work together and
beat up on everybody else. The Colorado duo.
When every American in the race, you know, feels it's their duty. It would be nice if there was some camaraderie amongst the Americans, but it's just like Chase Davis at all costs.
This is Cycle Ball, a hockey cycling hybrid popular in Europe.
Franz Kratochwil, the World Authentic Cycling Champion, look at this.
My Rolfer's a really good friend of mine. And she's a real naturalist, and she gave me these herbs. She said these would be good for your energy, you know. And I took one of them, and that's it. No Olympics, no Coors race, no nothing.
Hey, camera marker!
Your eyes aren't deceiving you. They did start a race called Hell of the West at the famed Morgul Bismarck course. Hell of the West is the race around which a Hollywood movie is framed. Screenwriter Steve Tesich of Breaking Away fame spent time at last year's Coors Classic, and he was back this year for more filming. He even brought make-believe Russian cyclists. The real Russians chose not to come to Colorado this year, that in addition to their Olympic pullout. So Morgul Bismarck was literally buzzing with an additional helicopter, cameras, and everything attendant to a major feature-length movie. Among the stars, Ray Dawn Chong, seen recently in Quest for Fire. But in the late afternoon, another drama would unfold. Canadian Ross Chafe, suffering from stomach cramps, had another lap, 13 miles to go, this as the winners had already finished. Chafe pushed on, and after more pain, the Canadian climbed the wall. The finish line was meters away, a convoy of goodwill, Chafe's companion.
Let's go, Chafe! Julie Moss at the end of the end is crossing the line.
It was really nice to know that the people were there. It's a lot nicer than coming across the finish line with nobody but just the banner there to finish. It's hard to really explain what I felt like at the end because I don't really remember too much of it.
This was the day Connie Carpenter and Davis Finney would announce their withdrawal from the Classic.
Hopefully everyone will forgive us for this if we do indeed come back with some medals from the Olympics.
The American coaches, if they are making an arbitrary decision, are either the very smartest coaches in the world, or they are the ones with perhaps the least background in being able to handle this kind of situation. Because the Americans are the only ones that are leaving the event, at least at this point.
But since he wasn't here, I mean, he gave me a better chance because there's no Davis Finney to watch.
Yeah. Hey, Brian Trevor, Ripsaw. Yeah. Hey, Brian, are you ready? I got to start. Are you going to do this introduction or what?
I bet this is the first time you get to get a kiss first when you're being interviewed. How did it feel? Tell me about the cobbles.
Those were so tough. I mean, it was just terrible. It was every man for himself out there. It was unbelievable. You were just so battered. My hands are going to be so arthritic tomorrow. I'm going to be dead.
Have you ever had a race like this before, Davis?
No way. No way. This whole race is incredible. Every day is a new experience.
Well, congratulations. Where are we going for dinner?
Hey, anywhere you want, baby.
Davis Finney had struck it rich. The other racers would get their chance when the Classic moved on to Gold Country for stage number four.
This is the gallows in Downeyville, California. They haven't hung anyone here in 100 years, but it is symbolic. For the bicycle racers up ahead, a 4,000-foot vertical climb over 20 miles. For some, it could be a long, slow death.
After 102 miles, Hinault won the race with this move. Staying right in Davis's draft all the way into the last moment and then using his tremendous power to slingshot by him.
Davis, you did all the work coming into the finish. How do you feel about finishing second?
Well, you know, I guess if you got to win that way, you got to win that way. It's about the least honorable way I can think of to win a race.
Why didn't you want to pull?
I didn't want to pull right away because I'm not stupid. I had the two other guys right there, so I waited towards the end.
Greg LeMond, famous in Europe, million-dollar contracts. Andy Hampston, a new pro, a man who only months ago was living on sandwiches and begging rooms.
I think you'll see Greg and I attacking each other quite a bit.
See from this angle, sparks flying up, other riders trying to avoid him, going into the fence right behind Davis, another rider going over the bars. Steve Tilford going to the hay bales, another Russian piling into the fence, two or three more riders piling into the crowd, and the carnage is over, and Davis Finney has escaped it.
This year, Morgul and Bismarck, the cat and dog, are Hampston and LeMond, who will chase, claw, and scratch at each other for 92 miles.
Up to last, grueling ascent of the wall, Alan McCormick gave his all-out effort, all the way to the finish line, with the crowd cheering him on. It was Alan McCormick grinding out the final few meters to win Morgul Bismarck.
Victory will soothe the pain of the winner. But in second place, Chris Carmichael's agony is all too apparent.
Yeah, well, he was away. I sat on behind him, and I was away. He sat. So we had a plan from last night to go from the blocks.
Is this one of the happiest moments of your racing career here? What's going on?
Well, I never won the Morgul. I always finished third and second and eighth. Today was the best, you know.
And you're climbing, too. You were definitely the strongest climber. Did that surprise you?
I climb, but you know, Maya Kennings is not here and you are not here, so it's different.
Congratulations, 4 years ago you won. This is your first race in America since then. Tell us how it feels.
Oh, it feels great. I mean, I can't believe our team's done so well, Steve won today, and I've had great teamwork, man, today. But I already know, pulled the last 10 laps, 12 laps, and just controlled the race. And it's great to win, especially with this crowd here in Boulder.
The special magic, when you wear the shades, your legs just go.
Despite a first stage win, McCormick would not be the race leader. His broken chain of a day ago left him behind the runner-up Van Fleet in the overall standings. So a bittersweet win for the Leprechaun, who fate would not let wear the coveted jersey.
This event is called the slow race. Good balance is crucial here. The slow race also requires incredible stamina, intense concentration, because a momentary lapse can result in a devastating crash.
All of a sudden, this guy goes winging by, this thing going, whoosh, whoosh, whoosh. Oh man, that is novel. I mean, like, give me a break. There's no way he's gonna get away.
Are you still in the hunt? Do you think you can still win?
I don't know. Bernard's, you know, same team. I'd like to still win, though. Yeah. You know, anything could happen. He could crack. Who knows? But it's looking pretty damn for me.
And Greg LeMond! Greg LeMond! It's gonna be there!
The broken dream then belonged to Greg LeMond, who seemed to have the sprint won when off his wheel came Russian Dmitry Konashev to steal the win.
I probably gave up too easily because I thought I had it. I didn't really push myself all the way to the end, thinking I had it won, and he just came zipping by me.
In a criterium, racers get a free lap when mechanical problems crop up. In the rain, a Davis Finney crash left him in the pits, and while waiting for repairs, his manager accidentally let the air out of his back tire.
Come on! God, I don't believe it!
Bill, give me some air. Bill!
Finney was just barely able to rejoin the race where he left off, and that group pulled further and further away from the pack on each lap. Finally, it would be Finney sprinting in for the win. For Bernard Hinault, the Tivoli Criterium would be his weakest ride of the Classic. He elected to play it safe in the rain and lost over a minute to both LeMond and Anderson. They were again within 2 minutes of him with two races and 166 miles left.
It's nothing.
It's better to lose 1 minute than to lose the race.
Okay, very much.
In the group was Davis Finney in the yellow. It seems certain today would be his day. He had some help in the crowd as well. His father, Damon, spent the day rooting and yelling split times.
Okay, Davis, okay then. 52!
This is the official race time of the Coors Classic, our event services official Greenwich time here.
Is the course just about completely set up, or can we close this thing down?
All our marshals are out there.
Going up the wall, my legs just exploded.
Yeah, I think I'll be an O'Grady Hammerhead, you know, time trialist type guy, and really put it to him, you know.
What I did was I bounced off the palm of my hand, and because I didn't slide really, all the force went right into my arm. I don't know, I was in such good shape, and I had really good form, and I was really looking forward to this race. It's the biggest event of the year outside of the World Championships, and it's real frustrating.
He had put himself in good position for the final sprint as the racers made the last turn. He's in fourth, when on the straightaway he misshifts and hooks his handlebar in the fence. He spins to the ground, bringing other riders with him. 7-Eleven racer Davis Finney won the race ahead of Steve Bauer, but the concern was for McCormick, who had a head injury as well as assorted other damage.
I got a terrible wallop off my head. I got concussion, and I just hope the lump goes down for tomorrow.
So another day in the...
Another day in the hot sun.
Another day in the hot sun.
For veteran 7-Eleven pro Bob Roll, it's just another day at the office. Witness the briefcase.
Here's my bag of stuff.
And in case anyone is interested, Bob Roll, the enforcer for America's powerhouse team, has this warning. Let them hate, so long as they fear.
Yeah, that was nice.
It was a cloudy summer's night over the Rocky Mountains, but inside some strange things happening, the Coors Classic elves busy toiling away. Soon enough, daylight. Rollout day for the Coors International Bicycle Classic and its more than 1,000-mile journey. Chief Elf Kenny Schwartz with his hat.
I mean, it's the most bizarre thing that's ever happened to us. We have a hostage that is in the courthouse, a series of hostages, number of them, that have been taken by some guy on some issue. We don't even know what the situation is. He claims that he's got the courthouse wired up with explosives. The courthouse sits right on our course. They're not allowing us back into the area, of course, to get our equipment out. So we have refabricated a starting and finishing area block away from the main location. It's the best we can do under the circumstances.
He rides one day fairly well, and then he's pretty sick the next day. So it's kind of up and down. He doesn't feel too bad today. We'll know after two laps how Lexi's going to go.
Graywall had enough of a lead to loosen his toe clips before he even got to the finish line.
Ladies and gentlemen,
and he broke the record for the event by almost 14 minutes.
I just hurt. It's no different today. I was just hungrier and I wanted to win, so I won.
I think I wasted probably the whole Crest team, which was, for us, my team had to do nothing but sit back. Lexi just had his team sitting out laps and then taking pulls, so, if that's the way they got to race, that's the way they got to race. But I still think I probably did some good damage to them, and hopefully my guys will just toast them tomorrow.
When did you guys decide to attack?
3 weeks ago.
How about today's race?
3 weeks ago.
I think tomorrow we have a big chance to win the Coors. We try anyway.
With the pack back together, time for a strategy session. Crest team manager Len Pettyjohn huddles with Mike Carter, but it's not advice the young rider seeks, but medical attention. One side of his body is numb from a crash 2 weeks ago. Carter hopes his drugstore on the road method of treatment can stimulate the muscles. Muscles he'll need to help challenge 7-Eleven.
It's not really even realistic that I can beat them. Obviously, I try, give it my best, but,
How frustrating is that,
Lex? I'm not frustrated at all. Why the hell should I be frustrated? I'm having a good time, I'm healthy, I'm as strong as I've been in years, I'm having a great time. No, I'm not frustrated. I didn't expect to beat them.
And when John Chapman talks, racers listen.
Fellas, stop moving up!
Jeff Pierce is not giving up. He's still with the leaders, but his rear wheel has been knocked out of alignment. So mechanic Bill Woodall comes to the rescue. He reaches over and loosens the back brake so it won't rub on the tire. With 10 miles to go, the race is on. Pierce won't let go of the Colombians. The award ceremony, and another giant in his sport, basketball star Bill Walton.
She just slammed me right into the fence. If I had kept going, I wouldn't be here today.
It's foul riding in the final sprint.
Namely what?
She blocked out Sue Navarro-Reaver. She prevented her from having a clean sprint. She moved over on her, intimidating her.
Boy, she better not come around here right now.
Now, let's see. Where's that feel?
Riders to the line, please. Riders to the line.
Oh, the Yodi. Oh, the Yodi. Oh, the Yodi.